Long, long ago, life was just hunky-dory. A group of people made a piece of cinematic glory. Now they're getting back together. Not in person only, virtually, but it's a start. They're reunited apart.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the show my mom calls
10 Minutes Too Long, Reunited Apart.
I'm your host, Josh Gad, and this, I'm happy to say, is our final episode of the year known in most quarters
as Hellground.
When we started Reunited Apart at the beginning of quarantine, we did it for two purposes.
To bring a little joy in these incredibly hard times, and most importantly, to help raise money for charities in desperate need of those resources.
Over the course of our 7 episodes, we have raised over $1 million and collectively helped many in need.
On this last episode of the year, I hope you will help me shatter our previous records
as we raise money today for Action Against Hunger. Action Against Hunger is a global humanitarian organization that takes decisive action against the causes and effects of hunger. They save the lives of malnourished children and ensure everyone can access clean water, food, training, and healthcare.
And today, thanks to an incredibly generous donation by our partners at Sony Picture Television, I am thrilled to announce we are kicking things off with a pledge of $25,000.
Let's make sure we make that total go up. Please click now on the link in the description below and make sure to give anything you can.
Here at Reunited Apart, we get lots and lots of requests, but one franchise in particular has been suggested to us over and over again. While some of us began a journey with these characters in 1984, others, like my daughters, have only recently learned of crane kicks, dojos,
and leg sweeps,
as we all gathered around our television to discover the continuation of a saga that began with Mr. Miyagi and Daniel LaRusso over 3 decades ago.
So now, as we all mark our calendars for January 2021 for season 3 of what is arguably my favorite show on television,
Cobra Kai on Netflix, it's time to rewind the clocks back to a cruel summer many years ago
and wax on and off about the man and the myth, one simply known as the Karate Kid. Ralph Macchio. Hey, buddy.
Hey, Josh. How are you, man?
So as you may or may not know, I do this little show called Reunited Apart. And, well, I want to invite you to reunite with the cast of, wait for it,
The Karate Kid?
The Karate Kid. The Karate Kid. Yes.
See, here's the thing, Josh. I kind of already do a reunion of that film every week now. So
I know that. You want to know why? Because I renamed my daughters Cobra and Kai.
Though it kind of doesn't really make sense to do this, and I appreciate it. I love you, man, but I'm sorry.
Yeah, I thought you might say that.
William.
Hey, Josh, what did he say?
He doesn't want to do it. I tried, but he don't care.
Couldn't leave well enough alone, could you, little twerp? No, you had to push it. Now you're gonna pay.
I'm not really sure what that means, but guys, listen, sorry. I gotta get going.
Where are you going, sweetheart?
Give him a front kick, William.
How would he even do that over Zoom?
Get him up.
I'm literally up.
Hey, leave him alone, man. He's had enough.
Shut up, Ron.
Look at him, William. He can't even stand up.
Because I would be out of the shot.
William, leave him alone, man. He's had enough.
I'll decide when he's had enough, man.
What is wrong with you, William?
The enemy deserves no mercy.
Guys, look, I can't really do this right now, and I'm on my way out to get my new bike anyway.
What's the matter? Why did you throw your bike away?
Because I felt like it, Ma.
Please, look at me when I'm talking to you.
It's really hard to do over Zoom.
You're crazy.
Who's gonna save you now, Ralph? You in or you out?
I just want to go home. All right, that's it. I don't understand the rules here, and I want to go home.
What are you so afraid of, Ralph? It's her, isn't it?
It's not even a reunion without her, and you know it. Besides, she was always into you more than me anyway, so.
You didn't stick around for the exciting conclusion.
What was that? His hand on her ass?
Her right hook. You think she sprained her wrist doing her nails?
She hit him?
That's an understatement.
Well, I don't get it. Why didn't she say something?
She shouldn't have to, should she?
I just don't know if I have this in me.
Fear does not exist in this Zoom, does it?
No, Sensei.
Pain does not exist in this Zoom, does it?
No, Sensei.
Defeat does not exist in this Zoom, does it?
No, Sensei.
Now what will it be, Macchio?
All right, let's do it!
You, my friends, are the best around. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to an ultra special episode of Reunited Apart, Karate Kid, Cobra Kai, Super Edition! Please join me in welcoming Rob Macchio, William Zabka, Elisabeth Shue, Randee Heller, Ron Thomas, Tony O'Dell, Juli Fields, and the creator of the hit series Cobra Kai on Netflix, Josh Heald, John Hurwitz, and Hayden Schlossberg. Guys, there is so much to discuss today. Why don't we start with Josh, John, and Hayden. Is it still insane for you guys to see this crew together as it is for me?
Yeah, no doubt. I mean,
like, at all times.
It's been an amazing experience. I mean, like you, we were just fans of the movie and of the whole franchise, and to be able to work with this amazing group of people, it is a dream come true in every way.
We have a lot of Karate Kid moments on this show where you walk into any given set, any given location, any given day, and depending on who's there or what's being filmed, it feels like you jumped into the movie.
Ralph and William, let's start at the beginning. How did the two of you find your way into the now iconic roles of Daniel LaRusso and Johnny Lawrence back in, what is it, 1983, 1984, when you guys start?
I auditioned for John Avildsen, our director. It was a script called The Karate Kid, and I said, boy, that's a lame title. If it ever sticks in this movie, I'm going to have to carry this sucker for the rest of my life. But what are the odds that's going to happen? I walked into John Avildsen's apartment. There were actors lined in the hallway, and I walked past, you know, the poster of Save the Tiger and Rocky, and I was like, okay, this is pretty legit. And it was John and a video camera, and we began talking, and then we read a scene, and you could watch that scene on YouTube right now. He put it up back before he passed away. We miss him so much, and he's shining down on us for sure. It all started there, and he, at the end of the reading, he said, I can't guarantee anything, and I may find Spencer Tracy between now and the time I shoot this, but in any event, I would take some karate lessons.
You know, I would have been better off if you just let them beat me. They would have been done with it. It would have been all gone once and for all. Now I got to carry your weight around, too. Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Good. Very good.
I had an audition for another movie and the casting directors remember me from it. I didn't get that film and they called me in one day. I was at the gym working out. My manager called and said, you have a meeting for this thing called Karate Kid. I went in and I didn't know any karate, so I didn't think the chances were too good. But I read the scene. I went in the next day and read for John Avildsen and kind of hung out in my car because there was all these kind of almost Johnnies in the waiting room and everybody was being more tough than the next guy, you know? So to not psych myself out, I lock myself in my dad's 1970 Volvo and crank some Zebra and wait for the casting director to come and say, come on in. And I had a headband on and I walk in and I did my scene with John. And then he said, all right, how old are you? And I said, 17. He goes, well, you're a little bigger than our Karate Kid. And I said, well, Bruce Lee beat up Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And he goes, well, yeah, you got a point about that. So then I went home and then it was a series of callbacks and my last one was reading with Ralph himself. And again, I was overwhelmed. You know, I've loved him in The Outsiders and here I am, this new kid. And anyway, we went in, did our scene together. A few other guys went in and did it as well. And I think I stalked Ralph. I stayed outside the bungalow until it was, you know, nighttime and he walked out and I just said, hey man, how did I do? And he goes, oh. He goes, listen, everybody was great. He goes, I told John everybody was great. He goes, but you scared the shit out of me.
You couldn't leave well enough alone. Could you, little twerp? No, you had to push it. Well, now you're going to pay.
Don't take this the wrong way. was literally the most perfect casting for Johnny Lawrence of all time. The world would not have been the same. Elisabeth, Lisa, 30 plus years later, and these guys are still fighting over you. What can you remember about shooting the first film?
Well, it was my first film. I had done no films before that. Yes, my very, very first one. And what I do remember, and I wanted to ask you guys, was the first scene we shot on the beach?
Yes.
It was. Oh my God, I'm so glad, because that was my favorite part of the movie. Because we were fighting and it felt so natural to me, because I grew up with three brothers, to beat people up. You took my radio, like all those shots when you're trying to hold me back and you're like, don't break my radio, all of that. I was so angry. And I feel like in that moment, I kind of understood what acting was about. You know, you just kind of like let yourself go and actually believe what's going on.
Yeah.
I didn't do anything.
Randee and Juli, what was it like being part of a movie called The Karate Kid and having zero scenes involving karate?
Yeah, you kind of felt a little isolated, but I love Ralph. Ralph and I just, I felt we had clicked in the beginning.
We clicked from the get-go.
Hiya, champ.
Hey. It's a really interesting part of that film is how on target the mother, the single parent, the mom raising her son was, be it bullying, be it single parenting, be it mentorship. There's a lot of that in there. And so with Randee, I had those kind of scenes that weren't the heightened reality of some of the other stuff, and it found its balance, if you will.
Look at those palm trees. Damn, do you know what that means?
Yeah, watch out for falling coconuts, wise guy.
Who here is the best at karate out of curiosity? I think I have my...
Randee.
Randee.
Well, Ron Thomas is a true sensei. He was actually a champion.
Yeah.
He was hiding his karate skills on the show. Ron, tell him about that.
Yeah, it's a true story. When my agent said, you're going to go audition for this film called The Karate Kid, my agent said, don't tell them that you're a second degree black belt, because they're looking for actors. They want to know about your acting. They want to know, they're going to train you anyway with this guy named Pat Johnson. It wasn't until about, I think, 6 or 7 weeks into training and rehearsing that Pat Johnson came up to me and said, you know some stuff, don't you? And I had to spill the beans at that point. But I was a secondary black belt. Now I'm a sixth degree black belt, and I was a world champion in sports jiu-jitsu. Not exactly karate, but...
I stopped at white belt, by the way, in first grade. All right, three of my favorite scenes in this film that I want to talk about really quickly. Halloween dance leading into the fight.
Hey, there's Daniel.
Where?
The shower.
How do you know?
I just know.
Every 80s movie, known for great montages, Karate Kid, in my opinion, has the greatest montage of them all because of Bananarama's Cruel Summer.
Nice trip.
And the All Valley Under 18 Karate Championship. Can you guys walk me through any memories you have of shooting those scenes? And Cobra Kai creators, how important was it for you to pay off those iconic moments?
That tournament and how that ended was something that when we were thinking about the season one finale, it was like bringing back the feels from that and to find those little moments. You know, the moment where you think that Daniel is going to pull Mr. Miyagi and, you know, do that.
Medic!
One thing that's interesting to me, I grew up in the San Fernando Valley. So every one of those places I had been as a kid. And you know how like the apartment in Friends is like one of the characters almost after a while? To me, that's what all those locales were. And I went to high school with Billy.
We did Shakespeare together in high school.
We did.
I mean, as far as some of the scenes you mentioned, Josh, Appleton was a stickler for rehearsals for the fight scenes, for any kind of rehearsal. And when it came down to the fight sequences, in between any acting scenes, there were always mats laid out wherever we were shooting. Shoot the scene, and then we'd go over and Billy and I would run a piece of a fight sequence, certainly the ending fight, and so that stuff was like a ballet once we got to do it, because when we were ready to shoot that stuff, we were really ready.
He is quicker, he is wiser, he is stronger.
Karate Kid, Part 2.
Please help me welcoming now two of the stars from The Karate Kid 2, Yuji Okamoto and Tamlin Tomita, as well as famed writer of the original Karate Kid trilogy, Robert Mark Kamen.
So Billy took anti-aging pills. That's great.
So you write the masterpiece, The Karate Kid. How soon after The Karate Kid comes out do they come to you and go, we want a number two?
30 seconds.
That's what I figured. Did you have the idea already?
Truth? Yeah. I just wanted to pay somebody to pay for my trip to go see my teacher in Okinawa. I made this whole bullshit thing up with a village and a landing strip and a helicopter pad. I just wanted to go spend time with my sensei. That's all. And I learned in the movie business at that time, you could game the system big time. So I did.
I want to go through this. You guys suddenly become the new villain and love interest of the franchise, respectively. How did you become a part of the Karate Kid franchise?
I auditioned for John the first time at the Beverly Hills Hotel. And then I got to fly out to meet Ralph Macchio. And oh my F God. I had met Pat Morita, you know, and Pat Morita is this, you know, is this old, you know, wonderful, crotchety Japanese American comedian. And we would make fun of each other and so much fun. But yeah. Yeah.
There he is.
Heart.
Rule number one. Karate for defense only. Rule number two. First, learn rule number one.
Talk to me for a sec, guys, about the importance of two things. To the original cast, the stuff that you do in the sequel, was that all picked up for part two? Or was that stuff that was already shot for part one?
Part two was part two.
But part two, the beginning of part two is the end of the original script, right?
The original end of the movie was the beginning of
part two. Yeah.
That was the original end. When John and I looked at the film and looking at the outtakes, and that shot of Pat's face, it puddled us on the floor. It was just like the embodiment of this whole film. And how could you not? And then Bill Conti came in and put the horns in. And it was completely over.
Who is responsible for the honk noise in the film?
That was Pat in real life.
That was him. Every fart joke had a tag on it. Yeah.
That sequence at the end of Karate Kid 2 is the most surreal sequence, I think, in any Karate Kid film. Chosen coming down the zip line, then the drums. Daniel doing the drum technique, and then the
live or die, man.
Honk. It's all magic. Yuji, was that fun going down that thing?
Well, it initially was, right, Ralph?
Yeah, he's got a
initially was.
Yuji, the first time you saw it and they asked you to do it, you were, here's your face. What?
I had no clue about how much slack was on there. So, yeah, when I jumped on there, it's just like, boom, and it just peeled off in a projectile to the ground.
Tamlin and Ralph, how long did it take you guys to learn the bump, 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 bump? Was there a lot of choreography involved in that?
Just enough. You just
taught me everything.
Oh, definitely.
That drum was shown to me by a man who just passed in Okinawa, probably the greatest living karate man in Okinawa, a guy named Choki Kishaba. And he was going to show me the secret to all karate when I met him. And he took out this drum and he did this. And I said, I am so stealing this. Yeah, this is the guy who was the most dangerous guy in all of Okinawa. And he said, this is the secret. And the truth is, it is. And Ralph performed just like the drum. He was great.
It was incredible. From drums to bonsais, this trilogy would come full circle in 1989 as Karate Kid 3 would complete the cinematic journey of Daniel LaRusso and Mr. Miyagi. Please welcome now the cast of Karate Kid 3, Robin Lively, William Christopher Ford, Sean Kanan, and Thomas Ian Griffith, as well as Daryl Vidal, the inventor of the crane kick technique, and William, the loser of the semifinal tournament match to Johnny and the Bill. Hello, everybody. Welcome. Thank you.
Thomas. A lot of boxes.
My screen is now filled with boxes of Karate Kid icons.
I got so many villains all at once.
So, Thomas, why don't we start with you? you're such a bad dude in this film. Tell me about the birth of Terry Silver and how you came to be the John Kreese of your generation.
I was fortunate enough to meet John Avildsen. I'd just come out from New York, and it was the first film I was ever a part of.
What?
You know, every step of the way, I'm going, is this a little big? And John's going, no, I want every little kid kicking you in the shins when this comes out, you know, and he got that.
And full disclosure, Thomas, of everyone in the cast, he was the only guy outside of me who knew any martial arts. Mm-hmm. He was a black belt in Taekwondo or something.
Taekwondo, yeah.
Yeah, one of those things. Thomas was a legitimate martial artist.
Robin, you are the third leading lady on this impressive Zoom.
Hi.
Tell me, Robin, what was the experience of shooting Karate Kid 3 like for you?
When I got the audition, I was like, I can't believe this. I was so excited. I did the screen test and I was testing against Heather Graham. And the minute I saw her, I said, yeah, I was like, oh, I'm never gonna get this. She looks like a doll. She's like the most beautiful creature I've ever seen. So just to have the experience with Ralph, I think we did the macaroni and cheese scene was such a dream come true. And I was so excited. So I got it. When I got it, I was just like pinching myself.
Where did you guys shoot that sequence, by the way, with the water? And that is one of the most beautiful.
Mendocino, the devil's punch bowl.
And then Ralph got really bad.
On the side of that hill, saving the nice. Bonsai tree. I remember one of the crew guys said, you know, you should watch it. There's a little bit of poison oak in there, so just be careful. I'm hanging off the cliff all day, touching everything. I wake up the next morning, and I just said to my wife at the time, I said, my eyes, I can't even, swollen.
So bad.
And we all thought, Ralph, you were allergic to being the Karate Kid again.
That's right, it was time.
William and Sean, I haven't forgotten about you guys. So you guys are kind of like the next generation of Cobra Kai. The one thing that sticks out to me about the third film is the amped up nature of the fighting. Did you guys both come in trained in karate? And if not, how extensive was your on-set training?
I had studied Shotokan karate from about the time I was 13 years old.
I'm a black belt in Shorinru karate. I was a black belt when I studied production. I have to say, I've been waiting 31 years to tell Ralph Macchio, thank you for giving me my line in Karate Kid 3, where I push you in the bonsai shop. And he says to John Avildsen, can you give this guy a line? Because I need something to play off of. And John says, okay, why don't you say, you take off.
You take off.
I never really got to properly thank you. So I really appreciate it, Ralph.
Daryl, I haven't forgotten about you. The creator of the crane kick.
Well, obviously it was the brainchild of Robert Mark Kamen, who I'm so happy to see today.
Daryl Hay.
Hey, but you know, he gave me the idea of the concept of, you know, the injured leg and standing up on one leg and doing the kick. And then obviously this part was something that I had to put together, or when they told me that I had to do something with my hands. So that's it. That's the crane kick.
Don't be modest, Daryl. I wrote something that nobody in the world could do. And I was sure of it. And this guy comes along, stands on a log and does it. And I'm like, oh, this is what movies are about. You just make shit up and people do it.
And I didn't realize that everyone in the world would do it after that. So.
This is now officially the biggest episode in Reunited Apart's history and about to get even bigger. It's time for young to meet older. Please welcome the stars of the hit Netflix series, Cobra Kai, Mary Mauser, Jacob Bertrand, Cholo Maridueña, Courtney Hengler, Gianni DiCenzo, and Peyton List. Oh my goodness.
Hi. Nice to see everyone.
Tell me about the experience. Actually, all of you guys, for your generation, prior to the show, did you guys know about it? Did you watch it? What was your relationship with it?
My experience with the Karate Kid was one that was pretty minimal, to be quite honest, at the very beginning. You know, I played tennis a lot as a kid, and my mom would always say when I would wear headbands that I would look like Ralph Macchio. And I was always like, who is this Ralph Macchio guy? And why does he look like me? Like, what?
I had like no experience with the Karate Kid. And I've told this story. I've been very honest with especially Ralph about this. It was my greatest mistake. I accidentally actually slept through my initial audition and realized this afterwards because my boyfriend called me and was like, how was your audition? And I was like, what audition? He was like, you had an audition today. I was like, oh crap. So I went like frantically emailed my agent, my manager. I was like, please fix this. I am so sorry. I don't know what happened. And I actually met Ralph at my chemistry read and then went home like 2 days later, got the call. I booked it. And so my boyfriend and I sat down and watched all the movies.
What about you, Jacob?
My dad had showed me the movies to me and my brother when I was good like dad. 8 years old. Good kind dad. Of like... It was like a rite of passage thing. He wanted to, we had to watch it. So yeah, I was familiar with the movies.
I had a DVD player growing up and I only had about 5 movies and Karate Kid was one of them. So I watched it over and over and over again until my DVD player broke.
I had seen the Karate Kid like a little bit. It was like a big thing for my dad growing up. Like,
it makes me really sad that everybody's referencing their dads and I'm doing the math and I'm like, oh, I'm
hey, Josh, how do you think I feel?
That's not that old.
Except my residual stream is great. I love this generational
dad. I was waiting the whole Zoom for that long.
How did you guys come up with the idea of Cobra Kai?
I mean, this was a long time coming. You know, the three of us have been friends since we were teenagers. And we all separately had our own experiences with Karate Kid, fell in love with it separately and bonded over these movies when we first became friends. So it was always a topic of conversation. And we were in our early 20s. We were young screenwriters in Hollywood. And I remember all we do is write all day and then just watch movies all night. We were big fans of the franchise, but also fans of Billy from not only The Karate Kid, but the other movies where he played bullies. So we were always fascinated with him as this constant bully in the 80s. And then we remember seeing an interview with him where he talked about his approach to Johnny Lawrence. And it wasn't, I'm a bully in this movie. It was, I'm another kid who is in this high school who had a girlfriend who he loved and was trying, had 1 year to make it work and was trying to turn over a new leaf. And this, you know, punk from Jersey comes in and gets involved and steals his girl. And it threw him off in this whole way. And I think for the three of us, we were like, wow, like this is a really interesting, you know, thing that we hadn't really thought much about, that like in his mind, he was just the protagonist of his own story.
When you watch that movie, there's so many colorful characters and you see Johnny, but you see those glimpses of, you know, the humanity there. And as Miyagi says, you know, it's what is the teacher quote? Now I'm the guy.
No such thing as
because a bad student,
only bad teacher.
Exactly.
And we talked about it as a movie for years. You know, we thought about it as, you know, this great way of doing another Karate Kid movie, coming at it from the Cobra Kai side. But you know, movies, the movie landscape was already changing. You know, this goes back probably 15 years now. And we just felt like it was an uphill battle to get there as a feature. And then it was really the advent of streaming, you know, television and seeing these longer formats that, you know, were working with a deeper story where you could shift POVs. And it made us realize, you know, that Johnny story can be the way in, but it can allow us to really turn the camera everywhere.
They all came up here for the weekend. And I could not get over how genius this was. I'm still amazed at how brilliant it is and how brilliant Billy and Ralph have taken this thing that became an iconic thing and turned it into this. I mean, they really inhabit the characters and flip them. And it's, I just thought it was genius.
Courtney, I want to get to you, and then we have a very special guest coming on. But what was it like for you to be a part of a Karate Kid spinoff?
It's so awkward and weird and uncomfortable, mostly. I tell everybody it's the best job I've ever had. There's literally no one on the crew, no one in the cast, no one anywhere near our studio who's bad. It's just awesome. Everyone's so lovely and Ralph, I called him Ralph Macchio, like full, like one word for like the first two.
One word.
It's like, you can just call me Ralph. And I'm like, Ralph Macchio.
it turns out that I am not the only super fan of The Karate Kid and Cobra Kai. It turns out that there are quite a few super fans. And one of them happens to be this next guest who is going to join us for a game of Reunited Apart Karate Kid Cobra Kai trivia. Please welcome a woman who needs no introduction, Amy Schumer.
Yay. Oh my gosh. Wait, you have to let me skim the whole thing.
That's crazy. My head is about to explode. We have Karate Kid 2, Karate Kid 3, Cobra Kai, all on screen right now, Amy.
I'm shocked. I'm shocked. I just both got my period and I'm going through menopause because of this. You know what's so funny? Josh's like, who's a fan of Karate Kid and Cobra Kai? I'm like, huge, yes, yes. And then also I'm like, he goes, they're doing it. Everybody's getting together. And while I'm typing in, even Shue, you know, he's writing, yes, even Elisabeth Shue. This is so cool. I love you guys. And I'm loving Cobra Kai. Thank you.
When was the first time you saw Karate Kid? Do you remember?
Oh my God. I could probably recite it. Which is what the Zoom is about, right? It's
an opportunity for you to
run through it in a way that's totally racially sensitive too.
Yep.
Oh my God. Amy. Hi, Ralph Macchio.
Hi, Amy.
God, I love you.
I've been so
oh my God, William Zabka. I can't believe this. I can't handle this.
Did anybody ever catch, you're all watching The Karate Kid, did you ever catch the t-shirt that Freddie Fernandez is wearing? Go back and watch the movie because I got to wear this t-shirt.
Bacon, bacon.
It's the making bacon.
It's of course.
It's a pig mounting a pig. And Don said to me, I had a bet with him. He said, it's never going to get past the censors. Ralph was the only person who noticed it. And he just kind of, you know, he just looked at it and then he just kind of moved on. But it's one of the, I think it's one of the great moments in cinema history.
Amy's going to ask you some trivia that we pulled. If anybody else has any good trivia, let's hear it, but Amy, take it away whenever you're ready.
Okay, these are tough, and they're for $5 billion each. Okay? That's right, from Josh Gad.
Okay.
Tapping right into the Frozen funds. Which actor was originally turned down for their role because they were primarily known for comedies?
Oh.
Okay, I'm going to. Okay, you're hosting. Sorry about that, Josh. Okay,
no, Amy, it's yours.
Oh, no, I think.
Courtney, let's talk about it.
Pat
Morita. Ding, 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 ding. Josh owes you $5 million. That's right. It was Pat Morita.
Right.
Producer Jerry Weintraub felt that the audiences wouldn't be able to take him seriously in the role. And boy, was he ever wrong.
Jerry wanted Toshiro Mifune. And he read for it like it was a Kurosawa samurai movie. I'll tell you something. The audition of Pat came in to read with Ralph. You remember this, Ralph? And you sat there and your mouth opened. It just opened. It was like, oh my God, why didn't anybody think of this before? And Jerry, who never admitted he was wrong ever, said like, you know, it's like, Ralph, you do a Jerry better than I do.
Oh, I love it.
I think I made the biggest, almost made the biggest mistake of my life.
This is hard. And this one is controversial.
I want to see.
I'll say it. It's hard hitting. It's controversial.
Mm-hmm.
What was Daniel LaRusso's original last name?
Anyone else?
Can I win the money?
Robert.
I'm all about the money.
Weber.
Yeah. Ding, 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 ding.
I have an original script that it has Daniel Weber on the script.
Danny Weber.
Wow. Whoa. This is a deep cut. This is serious. So everybody get real. You're the best around. Was originally written for a different film. Mm-hmm. What film was that? Mm-hmm. And if you need me to jog your memory, I'll sing it. You're the best around. No, I'm gonna. Okay, Randy.
Randy.
Rocky?
No.
Yeah.
Rocky 3.
Oh wow.
Rocky replaced by Eye of the Tiger. Equally iconic song.
This one is also a deep cut, this next one.
Which actor from the original film would eventually go on to play Happy Gilmore's mother.
I'm stumped. The only thing I remember from Happy Gilmore is that his mom's house is being sold.
Yeah.
But that's a big memory. That's good. That's a huge.
Use that, Jacob. It was use the that. House.
Harness that knowledge, Jacob.
Amy, tell them who it was.
The neighbor who gives Daniel directions when he first enters his new apartment.
This place is a dump. You should go back to New Jersey.
I just want to thank you so much. And you know, just so you know, this film inspired Lil Schumer on Long Island to get herself in a little gi and take karate. Nice. Made it to yellow belt. All because of you guys. Thank you so much. This was an honor. Thank you for doing this.
You're amazing. We love you.
Thank you.
Two quick things. One, I want to quickly remind everyone why we are here, which is for Action Against Hunger. It's a global humanitarian organization that takes decisive action against the causes and effects of hunger. There we go. I'm so impressed. As COVID-19 spreads, it poses a grave danger, especially in communities with struggling health systems. We must step up and respond to this pandemic. So please look at everybody's screens right now and go to that link and make sure that you donate what you can, however you can. Every penny helps. Thank you so much. Guys, are there any spoilers that you want to give me for season 3?
Mr. Miyagi taught me everything you knew.
Let us find out.
There's going to be karate.
Some actors in there.
I'm going to have a mohawk again.
Nice.
Oh,
I can't believe you would give that away, Jacob.
I'll talk to you offline, Jacob.
We have one last treat for you guys. We've spoken a lot about this man throughout the interview. The Karate Kid would not be the Karate Kid without the brilliant performance by that man right there on Robert Kamen's screen, the late, great Pat Morita. Going back, rewatching these films again before doing this interview, I was reminded that Pat Morita was one of the most unique, incredible actors, I think, who's ever graced the screen. So we would love now to share a tribute that we have done for the late Pat Morita as we say our final goodbyes. Here now is our thank you to Mr. Miyagi himself.
There you go.
Mr. Miyagi, what belt do you have?
Oh, canvas. You like?
Yeah, it's very nice.
J.C. Penney, $3.98.
Yeah, but
right. Wax on, right hand. Wax off, left hand. Wax on, wax off.
I'm so glad you could make it!
Oh, I would not miss this for all the tea in China.
Welcome to my island, SpongeBob son.
Now I must avenge my brother's death!
Having fun?
Sorry. Listen, I was just...
That's okay. Everybody likes to do that.
Still trying to get out wearing dresses, Clint.
Earrings with a sweater?
Dishonored the Chinese army, destroyed my palace, and you have saved us all.
Which one of you guys is fearless? Are you fearless?
No, I chicken.
Sam, did you get the straight?
Did I hit the straight? Huh? 2, 3, 4, 5, 9.
My queen's held up.
Sell me another stack, Shirley.
Did you just say goodbye in another language?
Oh, sure. Adios, amigos.
I cannot thank you guys enough for joining me on what is one of my favorite episodes we have ever done.
Thanks, Josh.
Thank you.
So nice to see all of you. Hey, Josh, why don't you end this by having everybody do the crane kick?
Oh, yes. Oh my God.
Since only Daryl can actually do it.
There's only one guy that can do it.
I got.
Oh, God. I think I just threw it on my back.
Daryl.
Here I am.
Get with it, dude.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's no better way for me to end this iconic episode of Reunited Apart than by going out with a man who sings one of my favorite songs of all time. I give you the great Joe Esposito.
Try to be best, cause you're only a man, and a man's got to learn to take it. Try to believe when the going gets rough, that you gotta hang tough to make it. History repeats itself, try and you succeed. And never doubt that you're the one, and you can have your dreams. You're the best around. Nothing's ever gonna keep you down, you're the best around. Nothing's ever gonna keep you down, you're the best around. Nothing's ever gonna keep you down. Fight till you drop, never stop, can't give up till you reach the top. You're the best in town. Listen to that sound. Little bit of all you got can never bring you down. You're the best around. Nothing's ever gonna keep you down. You're the best around. Cobra Kai.
Oh, that was nice. Tanner? We just finished the episode, dude. Where were you?
I was on a rival episode of your show.
On a rival episode of my show? I don't understand.
Well, you're not the only reunion show in town, Josh.
You just did your own Cobra Kai reunion show?
No, not my own.
Then whose?
Mine.
Sorry, Josh.
Tanner, we do not train to be merciful here. Mercy is for the weak. Here, on the streets, in competition, a man confronts you. He is your enemy. An enemy deserves no mercy. What is the problem, Mr. Gadd?
I'm sorry. I gotta take a really big, big old piss. It's just been a fairly lengthy episode, so I'm gonna go. Great to meet you guys, by the way. Both big, big fan.
Okay. What now?
Sweep the leg. You have a problem with that, Mr. Buchanan?
No, Sensei.
No mercy.
Oh, hey, guys. I would really appreciate it if you subscribe to my channel. Otherwise, they won't let me back inside. So please just hit that subscribe button now.